talking about Abel today. Not Abel in the Bible, but ready, willing, and able. And so anyway, one of the points that Ian hit last week, he was talking about being ready. And we're talking about service. For those of you who weren't here last week, we're talking about serving. You see, God desires for us to be servants. And we'll talk about it a little bit later on, but Jesus led the way to give us the example. God wants us serving one another. Yes, he wants us to serve him, and that's where it all starts. But once we serve him, then our heart's desire ought to be to serve other people. God has given us all gifts. Every believer in here has at least one gift. God wants you to use it to serve him and honor him, but also to serve other people. Many of you have talents out the wazoo. I mean, you've got talents that are just unbelievable. God wants you to use those talents to serve him, yes, first and foremost, but also to serve other people. And we'll get more into that here in just a moment. But here's one of his main points on ready. He said Satan will try to keep us from being ready to serve by using lies, fear, sin, and offenses. Satan does not want us serving God, and he does not want us serving one another. But here's my question to us. Why are we even listening to Satan? James chapter 4, verse 7, a verse that he used last week. He says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he'll do what? That's a promise and a guarantee. I believe that with all my heart. Otherwise, it's got to be taken out of God's word. But what is the key word in that statement, that verse? Submit. And here's what we want to do. We want to do life our way, but we still want God to bless us. We want to do life our way, and when the enemy comes in, and he will, and starts hammering at us, we still want God to get rid of him and God to make him go away, but we still want to do life our way. It doesn't work that way, people. We'll talk about more of that here in just a moment. But the Bible says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he'll flee from you. Here's one of the statements that Ian made. I'm not going to just read Ian's. I'm getting to my part here in just a moment. But these were really good, and they lead up to what I'm going to be talking about. He said this. He said, if you live your life the way God wants, there is no guarantee that God will bless you the way you want to be blessed. Here's a problem. We want God to bless us in the areas that we want to be blessed in. God, I want my bank account bigger. God, I want my wife, well, she can't be any prettier, somethiner. Get off that real quick. You're going to dig a big hole. God, I want you to whatever. And we expect God to just, like I've talked before, to be that genie in the bottle. We rub the bottle, and poof, he pops out and says, what, your wish is my command. We tell God what we want, and he's obligated to do it. No, he's not. No. God has obligated himself to love us. Now, we can't hold him to that. He holds himself to that because God is love. God is obligated to desire things from us, and he does. So we have to be careful that where we're obligating God to do and be what we want him to be. So if you live your life the way God wants, there's no guarantee that God will bless you the way you want to be blessed. But if you're not living the way God wants, it's a guarantee that God will not bless you the way God wants to. Now you really need to put your mind around that. God wants to bless his children. He really does. But he wants to bless us the way he wants to bless us, not the way we want to be blessed. And I'll tell you this, all the time, I'll reiterate it. God's blessings are much greater than what you think you want for yourself. What you want for yourself many times leads to emptiness, headaches, heartaches, whatever. So here's the key. As we serve, and Ian was talking about, we need to get in our hearts and our minds the readiness to serve. So there's the ready part. Then the second part is willing. Ready, willing. He gave three examples of why people aren't willing. Number one, it's beneath them. It's beneath me. Scared to fail and spiritual exhaustion. I told everybody this morning, I have no clue what he said, so if I repeat a lot of things that he said, maybe God wants you to hear it. I don't know. But if this it's beneath me thing, if there's anything that's beneath you, you think it's beneath you when it comes to serving, then you've got too much pride going on and you're thinking way too much of yourself. Now, I mean that in a positive way. I'm not trying to be mean and hammer you. I'm just trying to get you to wake up and realize that when it comes to serving, nothing should be beneath us when it comes to serving God and serving other people. You know, if you're too good to clean out a toilet, you're too good. If you're too good to go take care of someone or meet somebody's need, maybe you got the resources by which to do that. If you're too good or you're too whatever to do these things, then you're too good and you're too whatever. And that's called pride, and God hates pride. And God cannot bless you the way He wants to bless you if that's your mindset. You got it? Scared to fail. What should I be afraid of? God didn't give us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of sound mind. It's what His Word tells me. We don't have to fear anything. What are you afraid of? What? Yeah, you're gonna do something. You're going to look like a moron. But hey, we'll clap you and applaud you and say, you look like a moron, but we still love you. Go be the best moron you can be. You're going to make mistakes. We all do. We're not perfect this side of heaven. God looks through Jesus and sees us as perfect, but we are not perfect. We mess up daily. But our desire should be to get rid of the mess ups and make them as less frequent as possible, but to serve God, to be ready to serve Him, to be willing to serve Him, but also to be ready and willing to serve other people, because that's part of what we're here for. God wants us to have fellowship with Him. That's one of the greatest things. That's one of your greatest responsibilities, is to have fellowship with the God of the universe, the Creator of all things. He desires fellowship with you. If you're not fellowshipping with Him, then you're missing what God has designed, part of what He's designed you to do. So you're not going to experience the blessings that He wants for you. But God also, and all throughout Scripture, we see that God wants us serving. He wants us serving Him first and foremost. But if we're truly serving Him, if we're truly submitted to Him, then we're going to have a desire to serve other people. This church should be serving one another in such a way that it almost makes you sick. Oh, stop it. No, I just want to serve you. You're just awesome. I just want to serve you. But that's how we ought to be. But churches all across America, and we have a lot of great servants here. We really do. And so I'm not talking about you. I'm talking about the person sitting next to you. But we have some incredible servants here, but so many people, churches are full of people today that they're just consumers. They come and consume. Church is not a consumer sport, whatever that means. It's not. It's a participatory. Well, I have to be careful with that one. Participatory sport. That's a good word for me to use. I'm pretty impressed. I'm not sure if I used it right in the sentence, but it sounded good. We're supposed to be participating. And we'll get to that more here in just a moment. James 4, verse 17 says, "So whoever knows the right thing to do and fails to do it, for him it is sin, for her it is sin." If I know that God desires fellowship from me with Him and with other people, and I'm not doing it, guess what it becomes for me? We're afraid to say that because we're afraid to talk about sin, but God's Word is full of sin. It's sin that hung Jesus on the cross. So we need to talk about it because it's still real and it still happens and it still keeps us from God's best for us. If God desires for me to serve and I'm not serving, and He does desire for me to serve and I'm not serving, what does it become for me? Don't be afraid to say it. Say it. It's a three-letter word. It starts with an S, ends with an N, got an I in the middle of it. It's called sin. I want God's blessings. I want His best for me. And so if I want God's blessings, I've got to do it God's way, not my way. God wants me serving. Every one of you have the ability to serve. Every one of you. You're missing out when you don't. I want us to become a church that serves like crazy. Not so we look good, but so that we honor God and we do it the way He desires for us to do it. But here's what we do. We use all kinds of excuses. We can say we're ready to serve, but, you know, talk's cheap. We can say we're willing to serve, but talk's cheap. Not doing what you know is right is wrong, right? I want God's blessings. I can't have God's blessings if I do it my way and not His way. It's just that simple. That's why I see so many people who claim the name of Christ, but they're not enjoying their walk with God. They're not enjoying this thing called Christianity because they're doing it their way and not God's way. If you were designed to serve and you're not serving, you're missing out what you were designed for. Right? It's pretty simple. You know, I know I'm just a Reedland graduate, but hey, I can figure that one out. It's pretty simple. Then he used this statement, and I thought it was a pretty bold statement. And by the way, he said last week after he got through, and a lot of you have told me how wonderful of a job he did and everything, he said, but a lot of people wouldn't look at him eye to eye on the way out. Of course, he's way up here, and it's hard to look at him eye to eye, but he said a lot of people just ignored him and walked on by. Well, here's the thing. That means he probably did a pretty good job. Because when you don't step on any toes, people can't wait to tell you how wonderful of a job you did. Oh, you did a great job. And usually what they're saying is, thanks for not stepping on my toes. Thanks for not trying to convict me. You know, and we're not the Holy Spirit. We are not the ones that can convict, but we are the ones that are to preach conviction. Right? God's word should be convicting enough. Knowing that I want God's blessings and knowing that I need to do it God's way and knowing if I want God's blessings that it has to be done His way, that ought to be convicting enough. I shouldn't need me to stand up here and rant at me. I shouldn't. It should just come automatic. But here's what He said. He said, if you call yourself a follower of Christ, and remember there's a difference in a Christ follower and a person who professes to be a Christian. If you call yourself a follower of Christ and you are not actively involved in the life of your church, you're doing your life wrong. That's a pretty bold statement. And that's not coming from somebody who we're just trying to get all of y'all to do something. I want you to get God's blessings. I don't give a flip what you do. I want you to have God's blessing. Can I say that? Does that sound wrong?
You already do.
Oh, okay.
Too late now.
I'll forget I said it here in just a moment, so it doesn't matter.
That's
exactly, and I am getting old. But here's the thing that we need to realize. If I am up here just trying to get you to do more so that our church looks better and we grow, that's the wrong method and wrong motive. I want God's blessings on your life. And so I'm obligated to teach you the truth from the Word of God that says God wants you serving. And so if you're not serving, again, and it sounds like I'm repeating myself, and I am, but it's very important to understand. If I'm not serving, which is something God designed me to do, then I'm missing out on a great thing. So I want to encourage you with that. I'm talking about Christ follower and someone who calls himself or herself a Christian, and I'm going to hit on it really good next week or really hard, I don't know, however. I want you to come back. It's going to be good. But I probably shouldn't tell you what I'm going to talk about next week. You may not come back. But here's the thing. We've been, our life group's been going through Not a Fan, and a lot of you have gone through it because we went through it as a church here 2 or 3 years ago. But it's talking about the difference in being a Christ follower and somebody who just calls themselves a Christian. That word Christian, all through the scripture, it's only used a few times, and it was mainly used as a derogatory remark. I've told you all this before. Oh, you're one of those Christians. That's kind of how it was used. Putting a title on yourself, saying I'm a Christian, but not serving, not having fellowship. We should be fellowshipping with one another like crazy. We're family here if we're all children of God. We're family. You're going to have to spend eternity with me. Get over it. You think it's bad now? You can't wait. But here's the thing. I can call myself a cow, but I'm not really one. I don't know where that came from. I can call myself a lot of things, but until my actions and my life show that that's what I am, then I'm just kidding myself. If I think just going through life calling myself a Christian but never serving, never fellowshipping, never wanting to be a part of anything going on in the church, that's dangerous area. I'm not going to tell you you're not saved. That's not up to me. That's up to God. But I don't get people who profess Jesus that don't want to be around any other Christians. They don't want to serve anywhere in the church. They just want to come suck up whatever's being given out and then just go do their own life. You're missing out. You are not receiving God's blessings the way He desires to bless you. You're not. Guaranteed. You can like that statement or you can not like that statement. I mean it in love, and it's a fact. You're missing out. But there's a difference in a Christ follower and someone who calls him or herself a Christian. In fact, over 70% of all Americans call themselves Christian. There's something bad wrong with that number. Because we got a lot of high percentage of people not acting like it. One of the best ways that we can show that we love Jesus is by serving Him, by serving others. By fellowshipping with Him, by fellowshipping with others. You know, and it just works. So there's the ready and the willing, and you know what comes next. What is it? Able. I looked up on Google, and here's what they said about ready, willing, and able. well prepared and eager to do something. I love that part, eager to do something. Now, we're not working our way into heaven. That's only through a personal relationship with Jesus. No. But receiving God's blessings come with the things that we do and the way that we are. And so, well prepared and eager to do something is so exciting. When I see people who say, man, give me something to do. Give me something to do. I just want to serve. I just want to serve. And to me, that's exciting. But here's what we do. We look at that those first two words, and it says well-prepared, and you think, well, I'm not prepared to do anything. I can't do anything. And so we don't do anything. But every one of you who has a job or who has had a job or will get a job, or any of you who's doing anything, somebody somewhere either has or will taught you how to do it, or will teach you how to do it, right? So you go get prepared. Doogie Howser didn't just pop out of his mother's womb one day and said, oh, I'm going to be a doctor. Did he? Y'all don't even know who Doogie Howser is. These young people going. Electricians don't just decide one day they're going to wake up and work on electricity, do they? It could be a shocking situation. Plumbers don't decide they're just going to go plumb. Go plumb crazy. They just keep rolling in. I just don't know where they come from. What we have to do is we have to prepare. If I'm a waiter or a waitress in a restaurant, I don't just walk in and say, I'm here to save the day, give me my apron, I'm going to go serve. They're going to teach me the way they want it done, correct? And probably just about every restaurant has some little caveat that's different, so they're going to train you and they're going to develop you the way they want you to do it. Isn't it funny that we're willing to go to school and we're willing to go to jobs, and we're willing to train, and we're willing to prepare ourselves to do everything in life except serve God? So don't use that excuse, I'm not prepared, I don't know how. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 and 12, I'll tell you what part of our responsibility is. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for building up the body of Christ. We're here to equip you. And I need help with other people who are able to equip people. We're supposed to be discipling one another. And some of you are equipped to disciple, but you're making excuses not to disciple. You don't have time. That ain't going to hold water in front of God. I didn't have time, Lord. I was too busy making money. I was too busy doing my things. And Lord, that chick you gave me, you don't know how she was with me, and I just didn't have time because I had to do everything to please her. It's not going to hold water. God wants your allegiance to Him. And when my allegiance is to Him, then I'm going to desire to do it His way. And His way is that we serve one another and we fellowship with one another. Now, you can walk out of here thinking I've spoken craziness, or you can walk out of here and say, I don't believe that. I don't give a rip. It's true because it's from the Word of God. It's all through the Word of God. And I do give a rip. I really do. Well prepared, eager to do something. As in, anytime you want me to volunteer, I'm ready, willing, and able. Get it? Get it? We need that. Oh, I'm ready, willing, and able. Early in our ministry, I got saved and boom, we just started volunteering. Doesn't make us special, but I saw it in other people and I thought, wow, I think that's what we're supposed to do. So that's what we did. And there's joy and there's peace in it. There's blessings in it to help be able to serve somebody else and to do something for other people and then to encourage them. And then they start realizing, wow, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is what I was designed to do. You're always wanting to know what God's will for your life is. One of His purposes, one of His parts of His will is for you to serve. Somebody, somehow, somewhere, some way. So if you're not doing it, then you're missing out because you're not doing what God has designed you to do. So, there you go. So if you don't feel prepared, we'll prepare you. Turn to Matthew chapter 19. We're going to look at ready, willing, and able. We're going to look at a young man who we see he was ready and he was willing. But when it got to the able part, there was a problem. Every one of you have something to offer, every one of you. Every one of you. Some of you know God's word inside and out, and you're keeping it for yourself instead of investing it in other people. Some of you have talents and skills that you could be using for the church and using to serve other people, but no, you're just using them to make a buck, and it doesn't matter about anything else. Now, you're not saying that. That would make you a cruel person. You may not even be thinking that. But if you're not using it for God's glory and His honor, then you're missing the boat. You're missing the boat. Matthew chapter 19, verse 16. This is a very positive message. I hope you're getting a lot of positive thought out of it. I'm smiling. Y'all smile. Look, here's the whole thing. And I've told you once, I'm going to tell you again. I want God's blessings for you. But you got to do it His way. Matthew chapter 19, verse 16, it says, "Behold, a man came to Jesus, saying, 'Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life?'" He was ready. He was ready. "What is it that I must do to have eternal life?" He was ready. And Jesus said to him, "Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you wish to enter life, keep the commandments." Now understand here, Jesus is talking to a Jewish young man. Jesus has not yet died. Jesus has not yet gone to heaven and sent the Holy Spirit, and the church has not yet been established. Jesus is dealing with the Jews, and he knew that this young man would understand what he's talking about here when he talked about commandments, because the good Jews knew all about Moses, and they knew all about the commandments, and they knew what they were supposed to do and weren't supposed to do. And so Jesus is talking to him on his level, a level that he would understand. And he said to Jesus, "Which ones?" And Jesus said, "You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and mother, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself." So really he's going through the law of Moses, and he's telling this good Jew what he would know to be true. And the young man said to him, "All these I have kept. What do I still lack?" He's willing. He's come to Jesus ready. He wants to know about eternal life. Now he's willing. What is it that I still lack? What is it now that I need to do? Because I am ready and I am willing, and I'm not going to tell you yet that I'm able, but I'm ready and I'm willing. So what is it, Jesus? And Jesus said to him, "If you want to be complete, if you want to be perfect, go, sell what you possess and give to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven, and come follow me." Now here's something you have to understand about that statement right there. There's a small, and I don't know how big this one will get, but there's a small movement in churches going around today now that says, because of that and a few other verses, you're supposed to sell everything that you have and give it away if you're a Christ follower. That's not what Jesus is saying there here. Jesus is talking to a young man that he knows that this young man, his whole, everything about him was about everything that he owns. And Jesus is saying to this young man, "You're going to have to give away what is most important to you to be able to come and follow me. Because this is what's holding you back. It may be something totally different with you. I know with me it's not about my money. I just know it. If God tells me to give it all away, it'd take me about 5 minutes and it's gone. But God may tell me that I want you to get rid of this, or I want you to do away with that, or I want you to do something different, whatever it is." So understand, when we look at this verse, Jesus is talking to this young man in an area that this young man would understand, and Jesus, knowing this young man as well as he knows you, knows what it is that holds us back. So Jesus is saying, if you want to be complete, you want to be perfect, go sell what you possess, give to the poor, and you'll have treasures in heaven, and come follow me. When the young man heard this, he went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions. We don't see or hear anything else, I don't guess, about this young man in the Bible. But what we do know right here, when Jesus said, "This is what I need you to do," he says, "Nah, I'm ready and I'm willing, but I'm not able to do that. I just can't do it. Not going there, Jesus." The Bible says he went away sorrowful. Do you think he went away, and because he had talked to Jesus, and because he told Jesus, "I'm ready and I'm willing," and because he says, "I'm keeping all the commandments and I've kept them all for my whole life," do you think he walked away with God's blessings on his life? Absolutely not. He didn't. And we're no different than him. You see, many of you are ready to serve because you know it's the right thing to do. You're ready. You know it's the right thing to do. You know it. You're willing to serve, but you're unsure of where or how, and I get that. I totally get that. That's where we're supposed to come in. We're supposed to have opportunity for you. But it doesn't have to be within this church. There are plenty of places to serve outside this church. There are plenty of places to go show that you're a Christ follower, and I want to serve you, and I want to give of my time. I want to give of my resources. I want to give of my talents. I want to use my gifts to honor God, but also to serve you. There are a bazillion places to do that. I'm not saying you have to serve within these walls, but you know, this church sure could use you doing what you can do for the kingdom of God. And we can do it here, and we're supposed to be serving one another. So you're willing to serve, but you're unsure of where or how. But here's the thing, and here's what we all have to ask ourselves. What is it that needs to happen in order to be able to serve? I think a few weeks ago we talked about if you're too busy to serve, you're too busy. It's just that simple. You're just way too busy. If you're too busy to serve God and you're too busy to serve His children, who you call brothers and sisters, you're just way too busy. Some things need to change in your life. But here's the thing. Are you willing to make those changes? Are you willing to call to do what God has called you to do? There's one word that you're supposed to do that we need to do in order to truly follow Christ. And here's that one word. Is it up there? What is it? Surrender. We need to surrender. You know what it means to surrender? I'm under your control. You do with me what you will. I'm yours. Was it Isaiah that said, "Here am I, Lord, send me"? That should be our attitude. Here am I, Lord, use me. Here am I, God, do with me what you want to do. Look at all you've done for me. You sent Jesus to die on the cross for me. You gave me your Holy Spirit. You've promised me a place in heaven for eternity. Here am I, Lord. Do with me what you will. I want to serve you. I want to honor you. So what needs to happen in your life to be able to serve? What is it maybe that you need to get rid of? And I'm not going to go through a list of things because I'll miss yours and you'll think he didn't say mine, so I don't have to do it. But you know what it is. You know what it is that's keeping you from serving God with everything that you got. So what is it? How many of you ever heard of the comedian Michael Jr.? You ever heard of him? Funnier than all get out. He's a very godly man, and I encourage, if you like comedy, and I do, I love laughing. I love laughing. I love laughing at people. That's why you guys are just awesome. You make me laugh. But Michael Jr. was looking, you know, and he's a comedian, and I guess it's easy to say, you know, as a comedian, how am I going to use this to honor God? Because, you know, most comedians don't... Big-time comedian and Christian many times don't go hand in hand. I'm just saying. It seems like it's got to be filthy to be funny. It's got to be vulgar for you to laugh. And it's just so sickening. But this gentleman, he asked a question to him of himself one day. He said, "What is it that I have to offer the Lord? I'm just a comedian." You may be saying, "What have I got to offer? I'm just a fill in the blank." But I will tell you this, and this is not my notes, but if you're saying I'm just a nobody and you're a child of God, you're lying to yourself. And if you are a child of God and you're saying I have nothing to offer, you're lying to yourself. If you are a child of God and you say I have nothing to give, I have no gifts, I have no talents, you may not have any talents whatsoever. Talents are things that you work on and make happen. Gifts are given freely of God to every born-again believer. So you do have things to work with. So don't be lying to yourself. But here's the thing. Michael Jr. said this. He said there's two things that you have to look at when it comes to serving and fulfilling your obligation or your duties to the Lord. There's the what and the why. And the what is simply this. The what is the gifts that you have. The what are the talents that you have. Some of you are very talented in different areas. The what are the resources that God has blessed you with. That's the what. The what are the things. The why is what you do with those things. And the why is this. It's to honor the Father. Whatever your gifts, whatever your talents, whatever your resources, they should be to honor the Father. That's why you have them. It's to be obedient to what God is desiring for you to do. Remember, He wants to bless you His way, not your way. He wants to bless you with His blessings, not what you desire. But here's the thing. I have to do it His way, and He's given me tools to work with. He's given me gifts. He's given me abilities. Now, I have to go out and work those abilities, and, you know, God may want me to be a teacher, but if I don't know the Word of God, I don't need to be trying to teach the Word of God right now. But I need to be learning it so that I can. I don't want you teaching the kids if you don't know anything about the Word of God. But, you know, here's what we do. We think being with kids is just being a teacher. But we do need people sitting in there so that the teacher can do their job. And then you can sit in there and you can wrestle with the kids. You can put them in headlocks. You can put them in chokeholds. No chokeholds. No, that's bad. You can do things to get them to calm down. But we all have some kind of abilities. We all have something to offer. And it's more than just coming here and sitting and listening to me rant and rave and singing a song or two. We have to be careful with that. There's more to church than that. There's a lot more to it than that. So the what is what you have to work with, and the why is to honor the Father, to be obedient, and to serve. I don't know if I hit on the things here just a minute ago, but some of the things that... did I hit on the spiritual exhaustion thing? If we're not careful, we use that as an excuse. I'm not sure I understand that one. I don't know what it means to be spiritually exhausted. Yes, I understand that we all need time of rest. But don't you dare use that God rested on the seventh day, because God wasn't tired. You know why God rested on the seventh day? Because He was done. But He also gave us an example to say it's okay to rest. I want you to rest. In fact, He commanded His children, the Israelites, back in those days, He commanded them to take a day of rest. So rest is a good thing. But God didn't do it because He was spiritually exhausted. Some of you have gifts and talents and you have knowledge. You need to be using that for someone else. I'm not saying teach a class here. I'm saying for someone else. You need to be investing in other people. Some of you may not have the ability to teach right now. You need to be learning that because somebody needs to be discipling you so that you can get to the point where you're discipling someone else. But we have resources. We have homes that we can open up. You don't have to be a Bible scholar to lead a life group. And I'm not knocking those of you who are leading life groups, but you don't have to be a Bible scholar. You have to be ready, willing, and able. You know? You certainly don't have to be a Rhodes Scholar to make coffee. But we want you to make good coffee. But we'll teach you how to make coffee. Some of you can't make coffee. Some of us can't make coffee. But we'll teach you how to make coffee. Just simple little things, but so we can serve one another. Luke chapter 6, verse 46. Jesus said this. He said, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I tell you?" In my studies the last couple of weeks, I've really come to understand when Jesus calls Himself Lord, Lord, many times we just make that this super spiritual thing. Why do you call yourself God? Or why do you call me God? Or why do you say that I'm the high and lifted up one, the almighty one? No, what Jesus is saying is this. Why do you call me? Because the word Lord means master, and it means slave owner. Puts a different twist on that verse. Jesus is saying, why do you call me master? Why do you call me your owner, but you're not doing what I tell you to do? And we need to answer that question. Why is it that I can call Him Lord, master, my owner, but I don't do what He tells me to do? He wants us to obey Him. He wants us to love Him so much that we want to do what He wants us to do. And then here's the example that He gave, and I'm done. Matthew chapter 20, verse 28. Jesus said this about Himself. He said, "Even as the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give His life as a ransom for many." Jesus set the example. He says He didn't even come to be served, but to do what? To serve. If Jesus came to serve, shouldn't we say, hey, we need to be serving? Serving one another, serving the church, serving the people outside the church. Being the hands and the feet of Jesus here on this earth, when people talk to you, it's not about calling yourself a Christian, it's about living a life that says you're a Christ follower. And there's a big difference. And that's what we need to be doing. So we're to follow His example, and He was the perfect example. Because that's where the true joy and the true peace is. Let's bow our heads.